Good evening, everybody, and welcome to our March Benedictine Conversations. I'm Dawn Carrillo. I'm the director of the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, a ministry of the Sisters of St. Scholastica here in Duluth. We're co-sponsoring this evening tonight between the Center at the monastery and the Bregelman program in Catholic studies at the College of St. Scholastica. So I would now like to welcome Dr. Kevin Vaughn, the director of the Bregelman program. Kevin, thank you so much for being here with us tonight.
Thank you so much for having me, Dawn.
We're going to start this evening with a conversation with us, the panelists, and then we'll open the conversation to participants' questions and comments further into the program with the chat function or the raise hand function. Our conversation this evening is entitled A View from the Brink, Finding Hope in Times of Uncertainty. I have to be honest, I struggled a little bit with how to introduce our guest tonight, Dr. Parker Palmer, because there's not a whole lot new that I could hope to add to the plethora of information that is available for all of us. Saint Benedict tells us that we should begin each good work with prayer in order to bring it to perfection. And so I think the best way that we can begin tonight is with some of Parker's words, because they speak to us of who he is better than any bio I can give you. And because Parker's words feel so often to me like prayer. So this piece that I want to read to you comes from a book, his most recent book, On the Brink of Everything, Grace, Gravity, and Getting Old. Heartbreak comes with the territory called being human. When love and trust fail us, when what once brought meaning goes dry, when a dream drifts out of reach, when a devastating disease strikes, or when someone precious to us dies, our hearts break and we suffer. What can we do with our pain? How might we hold it and work with it? How do we turn the power of suffering toward new life? The way we answer those questions is critical, because violence is what happens when we don't know what else to do with our suffering. Violence is not limited to inflicting physical harm. We do violence every time we violate the sanctity of the human self, our own or another person's. Sometimes we try to numb the pain of suffering in ways that dishonor our souls. Suffering breaks our hearts, but the heart can break in two quite different ways. There's the brittle heart that breaks into shards, shattering the one who suffers as it explodes, and sometimes taking others down when it's thrown like a grenade at the ostensible source of its pain. Then there's the supple heart, the one that breaks open, not apart, the one that can grow into greater capacity for the many forms of love. Only the supple heart can hold suffering in a way that opens to new life. So Parker, first, I just want to welcome you. Thank you for being here with us.
Thank you so much, Dawn. And it's great to be with you and Kevin and the folks gathered at the modern equivalent of the fireside, I guess, the computer monitor.
So right. Well, I want to start in light of what I just read, wish I'd written that. Just to ask you, Parker, as we think about the sufferings of this past year, of that possibility of our hearts opening to new life, what are you noticing? What is sitting with your heart?
Yeah, well, thank you for reading that quote. That's a meaningful quote to me, and I appreciate that it's meaningful to you as well. And I think that whole notion of the broken heart and the two ways that the heart might break has, and also the roots of violence, when we don't know what else to do with our suffering, that's been a guide for me, those words have, during the past year plus, as well as at many other times in my life. You know, sometimes writers write what they need to hear, and you hope maybe it falls on other ears as well. But I write a lot in terms of what I need to keep reminding myself about. I think the whole question of how to respond to the last 12 months, let's just take that much. We could take a bigger chunk of history if we wanted. Is, you know, I think the first thing I need to say is it's just been a baffling time on so many, many fronts, challenging. One hardly knows what to think about it. I mean, I can do sociology and political science and psychology and spirituality around it. But at some basic level, I think what this passage in history has done to me is to force me back to what the Buddhists call beginner's mind. Mm-hmm. You know, to be able to say, I don't have answers to all of these things. And I need to stay open to what's moving in the world, what's moving in me, try to not be reactive to it, which is one of my default positions if you think quickly and you respond quickly, you react rather than act. Mm-hmm. And my preference always is to act creatively rather than react in what might be a harmful way to others or to myself. So beginner's mind, it kind of helps me go back to ground zero and sort things out. We have so much to learn as a country from the white supremacy that has so clearly been revealed in the period of time we're talking about, which ended, you know, it didn't end, excuse me, but which landed inside our Capitol building in Washington, D.C. on January 6th. In all kinds of forms of violence, violence against the police, violence against elected representatives trying to do their business, violence against democracy itself. It's very, very worrisome to realize that some of the conversations we get into are not in what we would have regarded a year ago as the normal range of political debate. They're not about your view and my view and Kevin's view on taxation policies, progressive, regressive, who gets the tax cuts, where should they be applied, or on policies in public education, how should we be holding teachers and students and high stakes testing. Those are normal debates which a lot of us have learned to hold as critical, in terms of critical differences, but still hold with civility. How do you hold with civility a debate between someone who treasures democracy the way I do and who feels profoundly grateful to have been born in a country with at least the intention to be a deeply democratic society, and someone who just wants to throw democracy out into the trash and develop an authoritarian form of government by means of mob rule? I don't know how to hold that debate, and I need to be honest about that. It's my intention and desire to hold every encounter in a nonviolent way that leads to the possibility of new life. But there's so much that baffles me. How do we hold, to keep using that image, 500,000 deaths from the coronavirus in our country alone? How do we hold all the suffering in the lives of people around us. How do we hold young people who've had that moment when they thought they would launch a career or a journey into the bigger world and found everything shut down, everything cut dead? How do we hold all the elders who are at fear of their own health and at risk of dying day by day, not knowing who they might run into and what virus he or she might be bearing, and whether they're bothering to mask or keep distance when that elder has to go to the only convenience store available in his or her neighborhood to get some food for themselves on their dwindling savings, if they have any. It's massive, and it's enough to flatten us. And of course, we have to, there are all kinds of ways you have to hold that. And one of them is with an awareness that small acts matter, and that you're not in charge of the whole situation. Community matters. And if we can come into community with each other as people who want to alleviate suffering in the larger world, then our own little actions get multiplied by factors of considerable size. We have to give up our obsession with getting results tomorrow and understand that we're in this for a long haul, for the long haul. We have so much to learn from people of color, from the LGBTQ community, and other marginalized folks in American society who have held critical issues of identity, integrity, safety, their own souls being at risk over the long haul. They've done what we're all now called to do, and we have so much to learn from them about, you know, both the patience that it takes to do that, and the sense of the urgent now in which it needs to be done. There are lots of paradoxes that we're holding. So I'm just walking around a subject to say, I think we have to normalize confusion, but not let us flatten it or not get lost in it, but keep thinking it through with people who care.
Parker, so you've been talking about the question of how to respond to the situation that we find ourselves in this country. And you yourself said that you're at first you wanted to react. And we've seen a lot of people react. This is a time of great passion. It's provoked. All that you have outlined has provoked deep feelings in people. And I'm interested in one kind of passion, and that's anger. And I'm curious, do you think that anger has in any way here a positive role to play in a response? Because I asked the question because we do, and we have seen it. And I feel that people are frustrated and that there is a lot of anger out there. And so I wonder if we could explore a little bit, how do we deal with that anger? What does it mean to be angry? Do you have any thoughts on that, Parker?
Yeah, I do, Kevin. Thank you. It's a great question, and I agree with you. It's important for a lot of people. So the reason I said my hope is always, my aspiration is to be non-reactive and more acting rather than reacting. My aspiration is to be to live a non-violent life in the world, right? But it's always and forever an aspiration. I mean, tell the truth, I think being a Christian is an aspiration. And I think sometimes we leap to saying that's what I am too quickly without really examining our lives to see if we meet, you know, the at least the minimum standard, which is about how we live in the world and not necessarily the content of our belief or our religious practices. So my wife, if she were here, could tell you that anger is part of my, I carry it in my quiver as one of my go-to emotions. I have pretty strong emotions, and I think as a white straight male, I was programmed not to feel them or recognize them. But I'm glad that over the course of what's now 82 years, I changed the dance on that and am now better able to name a feeling and to explore it, and then to hold it long enough and express it when it's an extreme feeling like anger, to express it to people that I trust, who are close to me. This is where community, I think, starts to come in. People who won't be blown out of the water by the sense of, oh my gosh, Parker's angry. The world or my world or his world must be coming to an end, you know. People who aren't surprised by me because they know me, to express it in order to explore it and to raise the fundamental question, how can I use this emotion as energy to ride it toward something worthwhile, something positive, something life affirming? Because in the long run, I think all emotions, well, certainly anger is an energy. And, you know, one of the things I've written about, Kevin, is my three deep dives in the course of my 82 years into clinical depression, twice in my 40s and once in my 60s, very serious, extended periods of clinical depression where it wasn't at all clear to me, you know, that life was worth living for weeks and months at a time. And one of the things I've learned from that experience, that devastating experience, is that depression can result from suppressed anger, from anger that is held as dead weight on your life because you're scared to express it. And I think there is something in the water that Christians drink that wants to suppress anger, as if it were, for example, nowhere in the scriptures or nowhere in Jesus's life, or nowhere in God's vocabulary. Well, those aren't the texts I read at Union Theological Seminary. I remember reading a psalm where basically the prayer is going up to God to smash the teeth of my enemies, mm-hmm. Which is an interesting prayer, you know, because I guess then they couldn't talk smack as well as they do, those enemies. But it's certainly anger, and it's not good, you know, it's not Quakerism 101 in terms of nonviolence, but it's an energy, and it can be a holy energy because it can harnessed and to the right vehicle, harnessed to the right mode of expression, it can take you somewhere worth going. And I will give you a concrete example of that, but everybody will have, I think, somewhere in their life an equivalent to this. I'm a writer. That's my work. That's how I've made my living for a long time. And in the last 4 or 5 years, I experienced a lot of anger about a lot of specific topics. The last trip I made before the pandemic hit was at the end of February, down to do a benefit fundraiser for a very remarkable ministry along the Arizona-Mexico border, where they were supporting not only refugees, but during the government shutdown, their food bank was also keeping border guards and their families alive because they weren't making any money and they all live on margins. So I went down there, they took me from Nogales, Arizona into Nogales, Mexico. And I spent the better part of a day at a shelter, a church-run shelter, for young families from south of the border who had horrifying stories to tell about trying to evade drug cartels on their way up, people nearly starving, some people being beaten and sexually abused, children terrified, and here they are stuck in a converted house down in Nogales, Sonora, in Mexico, where, you know, one bedroom that was meant for maybe a couple or a couple of kids was the floor was plotted out with foam mattresses, and there were probably 40 women sleeping in there, and another one where 40 men were sleeping, and another one where a whole gaggle of kids were sleeping. And they were running this thing communally and cooking meals and taking care of each other and entertaining the children in really innovative ways. It was very touching. It was very moving. And it made me very angry that my country was making this necessary. So I'm a writer, and I have some regular publication outlets. And a couple times every week, I had to distill, I had to rein in that, I had to harness that anger as an energy to write something that would be truthful from my point of view, that would challenge the principalities and powers from what I think of as a gospel standpoint. And that includes challenging some of my fellow Christians who don't read the gospel the way I do. But I had to do that in a way that could be heard by a maximum number of people. What I always want to do with my writing is to try to build bridges rather than walls. That's just part of my professional ethic. But it's a huge spiritual discipline when you're truly angry about something and you don't have any question that it's justified anger because you checked it out from a variety of viewpoints and with a variety of members of your community. It's a huge challenge to put that all together in the work you do in your everyday life, as I had to do with my writing, because to just blat my anger all over the page would just reduce my audience to zero, and rightly so. Who wants to read another angry rant?
I think of Thomas Aquinas talks about righteous anger, and that's anger at the service of justice. And he even says at one point, if you don't feel angry at injustice, then there's something bent, something out of whack.
Yeah, that's the way I would feel about myself, Kevin, if I didn't feel angry at some things, especially the kind of violence that doesn't involve a physical assault, but involves an assault on the identity and integrity of other human beings, as when we classify whole ethnic groups or nationalities or races in this way or that, which we do a lot of, we being white Americans and American Christians. I mean, it's so sobering to realize that the roots of white supremacy in this country are very, very Christian. Ku Klux Klan being a primary example. So yeah, there's a lot to get angry about. And then there's a lot to learn about holding that anger. I think a great service in education and in religious institutions would be to help people learn more about holding that anger and kind of normalizing anger as one of the responses of a healthy heart, not to be stuffed, not to be suppressed, but to be followed towards something life-giving.
Right. You know, I'm thinking too about the role of religion in what we're talking about now, because so much of what you're talking about is making me think about the prophets who would rise up and they were angry and they would speak God's anger. And so I wonder if you could just say a little bit about what you think the role of religion is in this kind of prophetic voice.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, these are great questions. I wish we had a week-long conversation to sort them out. You used an important word to me, Dawn, prophet or prophetic. I've felt for the last 5 years more strongly than ever that as a writer, I need to find both a pastoral voice and a prophetic voice, because I think in some ways those are the two major voices in the texts of my own tradition and in the living history of my own tradition. I think the role of the churches, if that was the focus of your question, I think.
Sure,
did I get that right?
Yes.
Or reboot it if I didn't.
No. Okay. Does religion have a responsibility?
I think it does. Yeah, I think it does. And I think, as a longtime member of various denominations and congregations, I have to say that I think the first responsibility is not to back away from all of this stuff. I think that in some congregations, there's a devotion to kind of holding an uneasy peace that gets held by not walking into these challenging topics, because it would get very messy if we did. My own belief is that the most powerful kind of community is one where we can get messy with each other and still love one another and still hang together. A lot of us, including in the Benedictine tradition and in the religious traditions generally, have worked with this notion of how do we receive the stranger? What role does the stranger play in our lives? And in both the Hebrew Bible and the Christian texts, the stranger plays a really, really critical role. From those strangers who appeared to Abraham and Sarah very early in the scriptures, and on to the stranger that the disciples met on the road after the crucifixion. Had those stories not been about hospitality to the stranger, in many ways, everything would have come to a screeching stop. Had Abraham and Sarah fired a warning shot to scare the strangers away, or had the disciples not invited the stranger to dinner, everything comes to a screeching halt in terms of the unfolding of the story. Mm-hmm. So I think that churches are afraid of strangeness too often, and they're afraid of us becoming strangers to one another. But in many ways, the whole message of all of the great wisdom traditions, I think, is that hospitality to the stranger opens up the world in a new way. So I'm not laying a demand on preachers, for example, priests, pastors, rabbis, anybody, to get up there in the pulpit and scorch people's ears. Although there are times when I think that might be called for, but that's their call, not mine. But I'm saying there are many ways that we can try to create religious communities that are open to internal diversity and help people learn how to hold that within the safe confines of a community of faith. I'll tell you a story that I haven't thought about for a long time, but it just came to me. When I was getting started in this business with training as a sociologist and as a community organizer in the late 60s and early 70s in Washington, D.C. around issues of racial justice, I used to get calls from churches saying, from a, a leader there who would say, we have a homogeneous white congregation. Would you please come and help us understand how to get more diverse?
Hmm.
And I would say, no. And they would say, why? I mean, we thought you were all on that side, you know. And I said, well, the reason I'm not going to accept that invitation is because there is no such thing as a homogeneous white congregation. There are only communities of white people pretending that they all think and believe the same in order that everything doesn't blow up. So I can't work with you any more than I could work with a unicorn. You know, what you're describing doesn't exist. But if you're willing for me to come and work with you through a series of processes that would open up your internal diversity and help all of us learn together how to host that diversity in a hospitable way, how to listen deeply to the person who has a problem that he or she feels is going to get them cast into the outer darkness if it were to come out in this place, this church. If you're willing to do that, you know, then I'm glad to work with you. But if you aren't willing to work hard on creating a community that can hold the diversity within a group of people who look alike, but where that diversity is tucked away. Why in heaven's name would a person with a visible diversity want to join you?
Hmm.
They can sniff that out right away. These people are nervous about differences, and the differences among them are invisible. I mean, over here is a member of the John Birch Society. Over here is a progressive Democrat. Over here is someone that someone who has a child who's just announced that he's gay, and others who have expressed judgmental attitudes toward gay people. There's a way to begin from within, which is where I think everything has to begin. There can't be changes in the external world until we're willing to do our inner work and our relational work in the communities where we already belong.
Parker, can I pick up on that point? You've been talking a lot about community and the importance of community and the work that needs to be done in order to build community and make a community authentic, one that represents diversity and acknowledges it in an authentic way. What does that mean then? Like what work needs to be done in the context that we find ourselves today? Because when I look at the world, I see so much fragmentation. I see so much polarization, politically speaking. But look at and also isolation. Look what the pandemic has done to us. We can't even meet in a single room to discuss these important issues. We have to do it over Zoom. And we're the ones who are privileged enough who can afford the technology and can actually do this. And so there are a lot of people who find themselves on the outside and find themselves alone. And there are other factors too that I think that contribute to that kind of fragmentation and loneliness. Technology, you know, whatever. You can kind of go down the list. So what in this situation where there is so much fragmentation and when community is so important, what kind of work do we need to do in order to bring ourselves together so that we can find some kind of meaningful connections with each other to make it through, well, to make it beyond the brink, to bring it back to our title today. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I do. And, you know, one thought, Kevin, is that things will never go back to what we have regarded as normal, but things will change. The day will come when we can do more safely in communal gatherings that are face-to-face. We still may be wearing masks, but that I think that too will ease after a bit, after a while. I'll wait for the scientists to announce that possibility. So there's that long range hope, but I have to say that I've been kind of amazed at what has been possible on Zoom and other modes of technology. And I agree, it's a huge problem that there are people who just can't afford that or don't have access to that. That's a, I think, a very important topic for another conversation. I think we have to start by understanding, by asking ourselves the question, what is within 3 feet or so of where we live in terms of what we can do? And if a congregation is still meeting on Zoom, as many, many are, and you can use Zoom breakout rooms, for example, as part of that technology, I think it's possible to do what I believe is key to your question, Kevin, and that's to practice vulnerability with each other. The great potential of a congregation or a classroom is that it's a mini community. It's a small form of community in which we can begin to model possibilities for the larger world. And I think that, you know, good programming within a church or a synagogue or a mosque is to model practices, ways of life and of being together that we would like to see spread in the larger world. There's no one big solution to any big problem, but there's a million, million little solutions, which is how big problems have always been solved historically. So if a congregation can create, you know, on the corner of 4th and Elm, or on the corner now represented on a Zoom screen, can create a miniature version of the beloved community, it's making a big difference in the world, because it's helping people form habits, relational habits, that can be taken out to the larger world. And, you know, I think there's a lot of doable practices. I think we can't get into a lot of granular detail here, but I've been talking, for example, I'll give you two quick examples. I've been doing a lot of Zoom work with networks of hundreds and thousands of young activists around the world. They're idealistic young people who are slamming into walls that they didn't know were there, and especially under pandemic conditions. And I make myself vulnerable by talking about my struggles with clinical depression, which had a lot to do with my heart breaking over things that I thought I could do that had proved impossible. And I had so much of my identity tied up with these things that I went into a deep, dark pit of not knowing who I was and of really kind of losing myself when things fell apart. I've heard from so many of those young people, thank you for helping me understand what I'm experiencing right now and how important it is to just keep putting one foot in front of the other and not hold yourself to the impossible standard of changing the world. Mm-hmm. You know, we've talked, you and Dawn and I have talked about this before, Kevin, within this notion of the tragic gap, standing and acting in the tragic gap. But it can't just be theoretical talk. It has to be, I think, illustrated with true stories from a person's life. And one of the things I've found myself just drawn to as an elder for these young activists is being honest about how long and how hard the struggle for social justice is, and how I won't see the results I want in my own lifetime. Mm-hmm. No activist ever has, and how that requires me to change my calculus about whether my life is meaningful or not, because, you know, the beloved community, despite all my best efforts over 82 years, has not arrived and will not arrive before I check out. So that kind of vulnerability, I think, is a gift we can offer each other. It happens sometimes because people are carefully prepared to go there. They're not coerced to go there. I do not believe in share or die events, you know, where it's compulsory open heart surgery on yourself. Mm. But I do believe in invitations to practice vulnerability if and when you're ready. Because what I've found is that when you do, other people start to open up. It becomes legitimated, and it becomes connective. We keep making the mistake in this culture, this American culture of ours, that we connect around our greatness or our success or our achievements. The truth is we connect much more deeply, and this is right at the heart of the Gospels, I think, out of our brokenness. Mm-hmm. I've had some achievements in my life, but I've connected with more people around what I've come to think of as a ministry regarding depression, either to people in depression or people who are holding others who are in depression. I've connected with more people that way than I think anything I've written about education reform or democracy or getting old or whatever. Leonard Cohen has that great song, I think it's called Anthem, where he says, forget your perfect offering. Ring the bells that still can ring. Forget your perfect offering. There's a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in. Mm-hmm. And that's where we see light in each other. And my experience in the last year, I didn't believe this when the year began, but my experience has been, we can do that as easily on Zoom mm-hmm. as we can face to face. And in a way, maybe easier, more easily. Because there's a little more distance that gives us a little more protection. Right. But it takes someone willing to do that, and it takes leadership that says to people, you're not going to be forced to go there, but you're going to be given an opportunity to explore something mm-hmm. that emerges out of a volunteer being vulnerable about this or that. You know, what if we had political conversations in congregations where somebody says, okay, I'm going to make myself vulnerable. X, Y, Z about what's been going on politically just drives me nuts. And I don't know how to talk to anybody about that. And it's really painful because I feel terribly isolated. I feel I'm losing family members and friends that a year ago, 2 years ago, I could talk to. And now life is just feeling very lonely. There's a lot of people who would want to say that about the reality of their lives. And with good leadership and some Zoom breakout rooms, the assignment is in the 10 minutes allotted to you in this one-on-one or triad conversation, having heard what's on our friend's heart, don't respond to our friend. Don't be thinking about what he or she ought to do to fix things up. That's their call, not yours. But pay attention to what's rising up in you about your own life, and to the extent that you're willing, share it. And just listen to each other. Just get in touch with the feelings that are flowing around this issue. Just hold this knowing and this interpersonal knowing in a way that might open you up to something new. Hmm. And then maybe next week we'll return to that and take a further step with it.
So Parker, if I understand you correctly, what there is actually strength then in vulnerability, if it can contribute to authentic community.
Absolutely. And I don't know, I don't know any other way authentic community forms except around vulnerabilities.
Yeah.
And, you know, it maybe is another way. I mean, the flip side of all of that is it forms around love. Mm. And it's if that love does not embrace vulnerability and the things people feel vulnerable about, then it's not love. It's cheap love. Like Bonhoeffer talked about cheap grace, and it's not worth a plug nickel. If we can't accept in our congregations the vulnerability of a couple whose relationship is coming apart at the seams, the vulnerability of a family where a beloved son or daughter is going off the rails with substance abuse, the vulnerability of a middle-aged man who's losing his job, or woman who's losing his or her job. The profound grief of a person who's just suffered the death of someone they deeply love. The confusion that comes around. So if we can't accept those, how dare we call ourselves a community? We might be an organization performing certain functions, but it's not a community, and it's certainly not the beloved community. I'll just say one more thing out of the scriptures that has always fascinated me. In biblical times, the stranger in those cultures was always at risk. I mean, just the way you qualified to get yourself killed or maimed was just to be a stranger in the wrong place at the wrong time. You know, the turf was marked out kind of like gangs mark out turf in the inner city, and woe be unto the person who wanders onto the wrong turf wearing the wrong colors. Well, that was the way it was in biblical times. Strangers were at risk by virtue of being strangers. When the Christian church began to form in the early days, during those first, you know, four centuries, the testimony is that strangers would look in on those congregations, and an ancient historian characterized what they said this way: they'd look in on those early congregations, outsiders would, and they'd say, "See how they love one another." See how they love one another. They didn't say anything about the theology, which wasn't there.
Right.
Or the cool vestments, or the rectitude of the practices. They said, see how they love one another. And that's what we have to model in our community life. And I've learned over the past year with people from very diverse places in life, with very diverse backgrounds, that it can be modeled online as well. Mm-hmm. I mean, it really ticks me off that as an old guy, I was so wrong about that, but they got me.
We have a couple of comments coming in here that I'd like you to hear. So Sally asks, do you think that the reason that many of our young people are leaving their churches is because they do not see or witness this vulnerability of the community, and that they themselves are often feeling extremely vulnerable and thus feel disconnected?
I think that's a very insightful comment. I could just say amen to it, because I think it's a very apt description. And I think that too often what the elders do that's really off-putting to young people is they talk about their successes. And they sort of convey the message, you know, I know you're struggling right now, but if you would do it like I did, you'll be fine in the long run too. And of course, that's a lie, because, you know, I'm not you, you're not me. We each have to find our own way on these complicated, vexing things. And the elders also get pretentious about giving direct advice. What we ought to be doing is listening, and not listening not as kind of, here's my gift to you. I listen to the young because I need their eyes and ears.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There are two basic human drives, I think, really fundamental human drives among others. One is to feel at home in my own skin, and the other is to feel at home on the face of the earth. Well, if I didn't have young informants in my life, and I mean people half my age and even younger, I wouldn't have the foggiest idea what was going on half the time, you know, because I don't know the music, I don't know the words, I don't know the dance moves. Everything has changed, and on it, not just in terms of popular culture, but in terms of political dynamics, economics, you know, as we say in Wisconsin, the whole kielbasa. I need young informants to tell me what the world looks like from where they stand at age 40, because they see a horizon I can't possibly see at age 82. It's, as I've told some of them, it's like I'm standing way down the curvature of the earth, you know, somewhere around the equator. And I can't even see the sun rising up where you are. You haven't moved down the curvature that far. So I need you, I often say to them, I need you to tell me what you're seeing, and I need you to speak clearly and distinctly when you do, because otherwise I won't be able to hear it, you know? So I have the most generative relations with young people, with a lot of young people that are like my scouts in this brave new world. And I've learned that they're sometimes as baffled as I am. And that's a reassuring thing to know. And when they ask, I'm glad to share something of myself, but it's not, I don't share successes. They don't ask for that. I mean, sometimes they ask, how do I become a writer? You write, you just write a lot. And you do it because you can't not do it. So we can talk that way. Mm-hmm. But what I share is my vulnerability. And so we connect more deeply around my saying, I can't understand exactly how you feel. Nobody can understand exactly how another person feels. But I can tell you my story of depression and what I learned from it. For whatever it's worth, I think there's a good word in the Christian tradition. I think it's called witnessing to each other.
Witnessing, yeah. I have a comment here from Cynthia. She says, "I appreciate you sharing about the suppression of anger, especially for women who are caregiving on so many levels while suffering multiple demands." The dance of anger and depression seems so much heightened on the brink of overwhelming responsibilities in the face of despair.
Absolutely. Again, I want to say amen to that. And, you know, I think this is a place where we also need, in addition to conversations across the lines of age, intergenerational conversations, I think we need, you know, intergender conversations. And, you know, for me to be in that kind of deep conversation with someone who identifies as a woman is a very important thing, partly because we learn of both differences and commonalities. And this kind of gulf between the genders, just like the gulf between the races can disappear or can be moderated or made more negotiable. The gulf between the genders can be made more negotiable too. One of the differences that I often talk about is that there's a very fine book about male depression, and I love the book and I love the title. The title of the book is I Don't Want to Talk About It, which makes me smile because that's a classic male response to an experience of depression. I don't want to talk about it. And I know that lots and lots of women have asked the men in their lives, are you okay? What's going on? I don't want to talk about it. Mm. And, you know, that serves no one well. And again, I think the way we start talking about stuff is that somebody talks about it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And models that it's okay. I think part of, I've asked people about this, so I'm reporting what they told me. Part of what has reached people about what I've written about depression, and again, not everybody's an author, I understand that, but I think we have equivalents in our own lives. People have said to me, well, the reason you're writing about depression impacted me is that, first of all, I didn't know that you could talk about that in public and live to tell the tale, you know, without being cast into the outer darkness, mm-hmm. marginalized, regarded as weak. Mm-hmm. I'm not a weak person. Sometimes in my reactivity, I'm stronger than is good for me. In that kind of, you know, uber masculine mode. But to me, talking about it and modeling the fact that you can not only survive but thrive is an important piece of my ministry. And my readers have told me that that's what they got about it. And then this, what they got out of it. And then the second thing they've said is, I didn't know how to talk about it. That is, I didn't know what words to use. Mm-hmm. I didn't know how to describe it. It just seemed so dark and formless. And by putting words to it, you've given it some shape. And when something has a shape, you can get a better handle on it.
Well, I have a comment here from Megan I want to share with you. She says, thank you for bringing a Quaker into this Benedictine community. It is lovely for me to hear Quaker echoes in this, my dear Benedictine community.
Thank you. Thank you. You know, there was a whole group of, a whole gaggle of people. I don't know, maybe they still exist in the anti-war movement, who called themselves Quackalicks because they were both Quaker and Catholic.
Great.
I know a bunch of Quackalicks from the
Quackalicks, that's great. I have a couple of questions here that kind of go together. One is from Greg. He wonders if you could offer an idea or two regarding care of creation. And then the second one is from Gary, who says, you write and speak powerfully about interior and communal processes for deeper understanding. Can you talk some about what you think is needed politically at this juncture in our democracy? Are there new structures or policies that you envision?
I'm wondering if that's from my friend Gary Bolhauer, who teaches at St. Scholastica.
I believe it is.
Who I love very much, and who, incidentally, for those who don't know, is a great poet, and he's got some wonderful books out. So you have to Google his name, Gary Bol, Boelhower, and look for Gary's books. Hi, Gary, if that's you, and if it isn't. I've just plugged your book, so it's thinking about you as I headed towards this evening related to St. Scholastica.
Yeah.
So reboot Gary's question for me, Leanne.
Well, Gary's question has to do with are there new structures or policies that you envision politically at this juncture in the democracy? And the other one, which may relate or not in your thinking, is one or two things about regarding care of creation.
Yeah. Well, as Gary knows, if it's the Gary I'm thinking of, I wrote a book called Healing the Heart of Democracy, which in many, many fundamental respects, I stand by. It was written in 2004, so it preceded our recent troubles by a few years. But to me, a significant piece of that book is about the intentions that the founders had when they designed the structures of our government. And those structures were tension-holding structures. The founders obviously planted some very bad DNA in this nation, because they contradicted themselves about all human beings being created equal. They contradicted themselves in a tragic and cowardly way. And I'm hoping that the day has finally arrived when we can't use those words anymore without cringing at how far we have to go to live into our conviction that all human beings are created equal, which frankly is a conviction that's not held by all Americans. Not as long as white supremacy is alive and well in the land, or any of the other isms, misogyny, sexism, homophobia, nationalism, etc. But anything we can do to return our institutions to that original tension-holding function is, I think, important. And that's, again, I think a conversation for another day. But if somebody wants to go to that book and see, you know, in more detail what I think about the chances, the points of leverage in our democracy, the book has some long sections about what congregations and classrooms can do to help form the habits of the heart that make democracy possible. Habits of the heart being a phrase taken from Alexis de Tocqueville's book called Democracy in America, which is arguably the best book ever written about American democracy, and written very early on in the early part of the 19th century. So I'm still, you know, very big on those possibilities and those processes. One of the things I've written about over the years since I started my adult working life, I guess, I mean, in a way, after I got my graduate degree, which is work too, I started as a community organizer in Washington, D.C. And I've written over the years and continue very much to believe in the importance of the way community organizers go about things, which is the outside the institution force in a social system. So if you look at what happened in Georgia, Stacey Abrams is the great example of a community organizer who found a powerful way to be relevant to the reformation of our political institutions by organizing a lot of disenfranchised voters in Georgia and creating an election result that pretty well stunned everybody. Mm-hmm. My own belief is that while not everybody's going to be a community organizer, I think, for example, about school reform, where there's been a lot of talk about the teacher as leader. Well, I think teacher education, right alongside content material, teaching content, ought to be teaching some of the skills and sensibilities of community organizers, because teachers need to learn to organize within public school systems in order to achieve best outcomes for students. They need to exercise countervailing power against the fact that teachers are the last people ever to be invited to the table when public education policy is being formed. They know the most, but they're the most disenfranchised in terms of the politics around public education. The same thing, I think, needs to happen in medical schools when we organize around humanism in medicine, as opposed to just kind of cut and dry, fix the broken machine approaches. Lots of things have happened that have been minor but still significant reforms to HMOs or to medical practice because folks got organized in med schools and then inside those HMOs. They learned those skills and sensibilities. So lots to be said about that, but I hope for Gary that's at least a hint of some of the directions of my thinking since that book.
Yeah, thank you. You know, I'm conscious of our time. This flew by and it's time for us to wrap up this conversation that could just go on and on. Kevin, I want to thank you for being here with us and for co-sponsoring this event with us. And yeah, Parker, beautiful conversation. Our next Benedictine conversation is in April, on Earth Day, April 20th, where we're going to be having a Benedictine sister, Terry Spindler, from the St. Scholastica community, and a Franciscan, Sister Michelle Lallier, a friend of mine in central Minnesota, who will be coming together with us to talk about the earth and the environment and the leaders of Franciscans and Benedictines. So watch for that email to come out and register for that. That's the April Benedictine conversation. Parker, what a privilege and an honor and just a deep pleasure to be with you here tonight to share a little bit in your thinking and your wisdom and your way of looking at things. And I'd like to end with a question that came in from a woman, Maria Cuzzo. She's asking, what are your most important pieces of advice for standing well on the edge at this point in your beautiful life?
Well, thank you. That's a lovely question. And I guess, you know, the jokester in me wants to say, don't look down. But you know, for me personally, the answer comes kind of automatically, which is I'm just so grateful for the gift of life. And in the pandemic have become more profoundly grateful for all the little things. A year ago, I would have been saying, "Whoa, I'm so grateful for that opportunity to do a benefit in Swarhita, Arizona, and then to travel into Nogales and have that powerful human experience, which was transformative and has been for me, and I am grateful for that." But you know, these days I get up, I haven't been out of the house much for the last year, little shopping and that's about it. And I look out the window at 5 a.m. and there's this trifloral maple in our backyard that the sun is falling on just so, and I'm so grateful for the pattern of light and shadow on the bark, even though all the leaves are gone. It's beautiful in a different way. Mm-hmm. And so when I look down, and at 5 a.m. from a second story bathroom, that's what I'm doing. I'm looking down at that tree. how I stand on the brink with gratitude. Mm-hmm. You know, that book, the book I wrote about aging, is sort of begins with the premise that anyone who lives to be 82 has to count himself or herself among the lucky ones.
Mm-hmm.
And I never forget that. And I'm so grateful for the opportunity, you know, to continue to think and laugh and hang out with people even this way, and good folks like Don and Kevin and all the rest of you, and continue to do my work in a way that allows me to keep learning. I mean, there's just so much to be grateful for. So, and I should close out by saying that in addition to thanking you for having me tonight and for such good questions, I need to lift up my Minnesota credentials, right?
Yes, please.
So I went to Carleton College. So, you know, I mean, that gives me Minnesota cred right there. I have enough Minnesota nice to pass when I'm up there. Although I'm originally from Chicago and therefore have some snark in me as well. And I married a wonderful woman from Winona. So that's a big piece of Minnesota cred, I think. And then finally, every year for 22 years until this last year, my wife and I have gone up to the Boundary Waters for several weeks in August and September. And we were just talking today about the possibility of getting back up there. I really miss, you know, in the book I say, I can tell you the zip code of heaven.
Yes.
And it is in fact near Grand Marais, Minnesota, up the Gunflint Trail. So if anybody wants to look at it on Google Maps, it's available.
The zip code of heaven. Well, I hope if you do that, that you swing up to the monastery and pay us a visit there, because we would love to see you.
Thank you. I'd love to do that.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Parker. This has been a real, real privilege and honor.
Thank you. Thank you.
And Megan writes in and says, Carleton Quakers in the house.
All right. All right. That's good. Well, let's all commit to having Quaker oats in the morning.
Good deal.
So on behalf of the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment and the Sisters of St. Scholastica, I thank you all for being here with us tonight, and blessings of peace, hope, and joy to you all and your families as we move closer to Easter and beyond. Blessings to you all.
Take care.